What an amazing thing to be able to do, to go out and to share the love of Jesus Christ. And that is so much fun. And we want to thank you, Springfield Assembly. Thank Sleep in Heavenly Peace and their whole staff. And of course, thank the awesome and mighty and wonderful God who supplies it all and teaches us to love as He loves. It's a good day. Amen. Amen. If I'm going to go ahead and dismiss the kids at Children's Church this morning. And is there on their way? If you're a guest with us, we want to welcome you to Springfield Assembly. It's really a joy to have you here. And it is our hope that you're able to worship God freely, receive from Him. And I'm going to invite all of our regular attenders to just give a royal welcome to our guests. Can we do that? How awesome. Congratulations, Pastor Rick and Sue, on those grandbabies. We're excited for you. That's wonderful. We're excited for church growth. We love church growth. And it's a good day. It's a good day. So I want to just quickly say this. Let's see, just a couple of thoughts. First, I heard that there's a couple here, and I won't mention their names, but George and Jeanette Glaze, 65 years of marriage. Congratulations to you. Yes. 65 years of marriage. We all aspire, by the grace of God, to be married 65 years. Congratulations. And Mike Giacomoni, thank you so much for those kind words and all that you said. I'm looking for Mike. I don't see him. There he is. And all you said in regard to Zach and Stephanie and our young adults and what's going to be happening there. We are really, really, really excited about that. But I also want to say thank you to you. 11 years of investing and serving and pouring into young people. You, Mike, your wife, Michelle, and you do it tirelessly. They look to you. You're like the Pied Piper. They love you. They look to you. They listen to you. They follow. They get insight from you. You've done that. You and your wife have done that through a lot of your own hardships, but you've been faithful. And heaven knows, God knows, and how much. We don't all know, but heaven knows. But thank you from the bottom of our heart. And I know we're clapping a lot this morning. Let's do it again for this great couple. That's awesome. Your hands are going to be sore after we're done here. And if you have your Bibles this morning, go ahead and take them out and go to Matthew chapter 18. Matthew chapter 18. As you're turning to Matthew chapter 18, I'll just mention one other thing. And that is that we, as was announced, we are having a brand new kind of a semester, new launch, if you will, of our Connect groups. And on the 8th of September, so this coming Sunday, we are going to be having our group leaders, the facilitators, and the hosts in the lobby after service. We want you to be able to meet them, talk to them. We want you to be able to find out about it. Sign up for a Connect group. You say, you know what, Eric? I'm already signed up. I've been in a Connect group. Guess what? We're erasing the roster of every Connect group. So if you're in a group and you want to stay in it, you have to sign up again next week. That's how much we love you here at Springfield Assembly. Now, we're going to do that and just kind of start fresh. So we encourage you to make note of that. Come find out about it. Not only are our Connect groups a really powerful way for you to develop relationships with other people, it's hard on a Sunday morning. It happens fast, goes by, you make it out the door, you get into the worries of the week. Connect groups are a great way to really get closer, but also it's a way to grow. We believe and we're committed to the fact that when we grow smaller together in these groups, something powerful happens there and we can grow in Christ, and that's what God wants us to do. So make note next week, Connect groups. Having said that, I want to start this morning by sharing a sentence with you, and I want you to think to yourself, what does this sentence mean? What does it mean? It's very simple. Here's the sentence. That was the perfect date. That was the perfect date. Where does your mind go when you hear those words? That was the perfect date. Maybe you're thinking about the couple reminiscing about that perfect date that they enjoyed together. That was a perfect date. Or maybe your mind goes to the group of people who had an event, and they had a wonderful event, and they said that was a perfect date, a gathering of some kind. That was the perfect date on the calendar. We picked just the right date. Or that was the perfect date. The person who goes to the grocery store, they're healthy, they come home, they open their box of dates, and they eat a little date, and they say, that was the perfect date. What changed in each of those? The context. This morning we're in Matthew chapter 18. Matthew chapter 18 is a very interesting chapter because Matthew chapter 18 talks about being greatest in the kingdom of heaven. It talks about not causing your brother or sister to stumble. It talks about going after the one who's lost, leaving the 99 to go after the one. It talks about the big subject of church discipline. And it talks about the parable that we're going to look at this morning, the parable of the unmerciful servant. And all, if you're a student of the Bible, all of these different things are things that you've heard about, you've talked about, you've read about, you've maybe shared the messages, you've shared verses from Matthew chapter 18. What I want to tell you this morning is that Matthew chapter 18 is actually one of many in the Gospels sermons of Jesus. It is a cohesive sermon. It is like a message. We've heard of the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. This is another sermon of Christ, and if we miss the context, we can miss the whole thing. If we miss what Jesus is saying, we might take a part of it out, think of it in one way, and miss it because we don't see the whole context. So, lest we do that, let's look at verse 1. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Who then is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" I just want to stop there and just begin to talk about what this whole message or this sermon of Jesus is about. And we see it's about a kingdom, the kingdom of heaven. We know a little bit about it. We've talked about it on Sunday morning. We know there is this thing, the kingdom of heaven. One day, the book of Revelation tells us that the kingdom of this world will become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ. What we realize is one day it will be as if we would understand this kingdom that's very, very, in a sense, tangible and there. But what we know now about the kingdom of God is you can't see it. It's not here or there. The kingdom of God, we learn from the scripture, is within us, and so there is this thing called the kingdom of God, and this sermon, and so the parable is about this kingdom. If I asked you and I said, think of a kingdom today, there are not many kingdoms in the world today. There's maybe some in Africa, there's in the Middle East, of course, Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, there's still kingdoms that exist. Liechtenstein, I think, is one. And if I said, describe it, where would you go? What would you begin to say when you described it? Well, first, if you described a kingdom, you begin to talk about the kingdom's king. Kingdom has a king. And so when we get the context of Matthew 18, we're talking about a kingdom and we're talking about a king. And if we go on and we talk about the context, it's the kingdom and the king. And the nature of the kingdom, what kind of a kingdom is it? Is it a good kingdom, a bad kingdom, a kind kingdom? What's the nature of the kingdom? And what about the people? Is it large or small? We talk about the nature of the kingdom, and we also talk about the subjects of the kingdom. Look at verse 2 of Matthew 18. Jesus begins to answer the question. He called a little child to him and placed the child among them. It said, "Truly I tell you, unless you change and become like little children, you'll never," and you want to think about this for a moment and maybe even underline what he's saying there, "you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever takes the," and this is important, "the lowly position of this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." Jesus uses a child as an example to talk about the subjects of the kingdom. He's talking about you. He's talking about me. He's saying we are to be like children. He's saying we're to be like children. This may be a good point for me to say, listen, if you want to learn more what it means to be part of the kingdom of God, you might want to volunteer for the nursery. So this morning, when Jesus comes to a place where he talks about how we're to be in the kingdom of God, he talks about the lowly position of this child. In verse 5, and whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. Gives us the context. It is a picture of people who are children of God, children of the King, who are lowly, humble, meek, mild, and treat one another the same way. That's the picture and the nature of the context of the passage. And then he goes on. With that being the case, verses 6 through 9, God forbid that we cause someone else to sin. And so he talks about that. What happens? What do we think? How do we act? Verses 10 through 14, what happens if one of the children wanders off? What do we do? How do we look at that? Verses 15 through 20, what do we do if a believer gets caught in sin? What do we do if a believer gets caught in sin? How do we act? And then that's the context. It's thinking, think people in the kingdom who are lowly and meek and humble. That's the nature of the thing and how we treat one another. And then all of a sudden, talking about what happens if one of them sins. And Peter says, he steps up, look at verse 21. Good old Peter, we can count on him. Comes to Jesus and asks, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to seven times? The question here then is, how do we react when somebody sins against us? What do we do? And that's the question before Jesus. That's what leads him into the parable he's about to go into. That's the question we're looking at this morning. So we go to the nursery and we see little Susie and little Jimmy playing with blocks and their Hello Kitty blocks, and Jimmy steals Susie's Hello Kitty blocks and she starts to cry. And you think, oh no, it's a tragedy, and you look closely at it, and it seems like that for a moment, but if you've ever been around little kids long enough, you know what happens. They get over it, and then before long, you turn away and you come back, you help it out, and they're smiling and laughing again. And that happens a few times that week, and maybe if you go back the next week, and for 100 weeks, the same thing happens. There's the little scuffle over the blocks, and then there's the resolution, and then there's the laughter again, and then it all is good. Just like little children. So this morning, we learn from them, and so Peter starts and he asks, before we look at it more closely, in Jesus' response, I'd like us to pray. Father, in Jesus' name, let the holy word, the power of your word, come into our lives and change us, make us new, God. Lord, lighten the burden, lighten the load, refresh your children. Lord, by the washing and the cleansing of the Word of God, lift any kind of stuff off of us that doesn't need to be there, inside and out. And Father, I pray that I would decrease, that you would increase, and you'd be so pleased, because we, your children, run after the truth of your Word. Help us to do that by your Holy Spirit, we pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Amen. So Peter asked this question, how many times should we forgive? Up to seven times. And there have been some people who've taught on this or wrote about it, and they talk about maybe the rabbinic approach to say you forgive somebody up to three times. You might have read that or heard that before. That seems to be a mistaken notion. There's no rabbinic approach that says that. Peter's just asking. Maybe he's referring back to something else Jesus has said another time, but he asks, up to seven times Jesus replies, Jesus answered, I tell you, verse 22, not seven times, but 77 times. He comes back with a large number. Some, you could translate this 70 times seven. That's how many times. It's a huge number, a big number. And it's clear, the message is clear. How do we react? How many times we forgive, and we keep forgiving, and we keep doing this, and we don't stop. The problem is that's not easy. What Jesus says when Peter asks, the bar is so high, you keep doing it again and again and again and again. There's just not a number here. The idea is we keep forgiving, and the bar is so high, it almost seems impossible. I don't know if you've ever worked on a file or you've been doing a paper and you're typing away, you're working away, you're laboring away, everything's going well, and then all of a sudden your hard disk fails or something happens or you lose your work and you go to find it and you can't get it again, and then you have to do it all over. If you've ever had that situation, you know how awful that is. You do it again. What would you do if it happened a second time? And a third time, and a fourth time, and a fifth time. When do you finally say, I'm not doing that anymore. I'm not going to write that paper again. I'm done. And Jesus doesn't give us that opportunity when it comes to people who sin against us. You don't have that option. You have to do it all over again. You do it all over again. You do it all over again. And then when you think about it, and you begin to put it in your own life, and you think about the types of things that you might have to forgive, you recognize this, the bar is so high, it's impossible. How do we go there? So Jesus, in order to help you and me this morning understand how in the world we can do this, he gives us a parable. Verse 23, he starts. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts. I want you to see a couple words and we'll come back to the word therefore, and the kingdom of heaven is like a king. There's focus on the king. A king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. We come to the first place this morning. I'm not the first to say this. Many, many people have said this. But what we learn this morning is that we're never more like God than when we forgive. We're never more like God than when we forgive our brother and our sister, and we do it from our heart. And that's the ethic of the kingdom of God. God wants us to be able to do this. This may seem impossible, but he's the God of the impossible. We can do this with God's help. And I want us to remember the context, the kingdom of heaven and the king. We focus on the king. We're the servants. And it's time to settle accounts. And there's a servant that goes before the king to settle his account. And the picture of the servant is a picture of you, and it's a picture of me. So it's a very important picture. We need to understand it. We're standing before the king just like the servant, and the servant owes 10,000 bags of gold to the king. 10,000 talents, some translations say. One of these bags of gold, one of these talents of gold, would be enough to sustain a day worker. It'd be the wages of a day worker for 20 years. So when we say 10,000 talents, we're talking about a large, large sum of money, maybe 4, maybe 8, maybe $12 billion. That's how much money we're talking. Stands before the king. Billions and billions of dollars in debt. He stands before the king. That's us. Verse 26. At this, the servant fell on his knees before him. Be patient with me, he begged. And I'll pay back everything. And the servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. The king canceled the debt. The king forgave the debt. It is the heart of God to forgive your debt. It is the heart of God to forgive my debt. It's the heart of God to forgive. The king forgave all of that debt. That's the point. This is awesome. I don't know about you, but sometimes when I'm getting ready to go out, I struggle even to get my hair fixed just right. I struggle, and some of you do too, and you've got a thing that we call maybe a cowlick or something, and you work and pay special attention to that thing. You're going to comb it over. You're going to put your hair product in. You're going to try to get it just right, make it work, maybe, you know, blow it out a little bit, kind of work the thing in. Hopefully it looks, look in the mirror, make, oh, we got to try it again, fluff it up, make it work. Think about this, just to fix our hair, we struggle. We can't do that. Some of us struggle to balance our checkbook. Some of us struggle to clean our room. Some of us struggle with geometry and other things. We struggle with so many things in this life. And yet now here, we're facing this reality of having to settle an account with the King of Kings, that is beyond ever being able to pay. But the heart of God, thank you, Jesus, the heart of God is to forgive the debt. Isaiah 1:18, come now, let us settle the matter, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they're red as crimson, they shall be like wool. Ephesians 1, verse 7, in him we have redemption through his blood. It's the blood of Jesus. That's the grace of Jesus. That's the work of the cross. That's what we just remembered when we went to communion. And look what it says. We have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with, and I want you to see these words, the riches of God's grace. The riches, the wealth, the abounding, just magnificent, just measureless. You can't measure his grace that he lavished on us, Ephesians 2:4. But because of his great love for us, God, here's that word again, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. How have we been saved? By God's abundant, matchless, rich, wonderful, powerful, never-ending grace. The man stood before God, and God forgave all before the king, and the king forgave all. And if we want to be like our Heavenly Father, we're never more like him than when we forgive. Verse 27, what does the king's forgiveness look like? What should it look like in us? The servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. Took pity might be moved with compassion. We saw this word before. It means he was moved from the inside. He really, really cared about that man who was there before him with this debt. He cared from his inside out. He cared. He canceled the debt. That means he forgave the debt. And then it says he let him go. He freed him. That's a great pattern for us. Here's the pattern. Compassion. You need to forgive somebody today. Where does it start? It starts with really looking at that person, forgetting the sin. They sinned against you. Forget the sin. Look at the person. How do you look at them? Look at them like God looks at them. From the inside, you have compassion on them. What do? You forgive them. Second part, you forgive. You forgive. Third thing, what do? You let them go. You free them. What does that mean? That means you don't hold it over their head. You don't keep bringing it up again. You just let them be free. That's what God does with us. He frees us. We're free. That's the king. That's the example. We're never more like God than when we do that. The problem is that's so hard to do, it seems impossible. Number two, how do we begin to get there? The word is remember. Remember the Lord's grace to you every day, every single day. Verse 28. When that servant went out, look what he did. He found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins. He grabbed him and began to choke him. Pay back what you owe me, he demanded. Verse 29, his fellow servant fell to his knees, begged him, be patient with me and I'll pay it back. It's exactly like the former part of the story, the earlier part of the story. It's exactly the same on purpose, same scenario, different amount of money. But don't miss this. It's 100 silver coins. Jesus knows what he's doing when he's trying to instruct us. It's 100 silver coins. We can't rate our effort in fulfilling what God has called us to fulfill with the help of Christ when we look at the easy things in life. It's the hard things in life that really define who we are and if we're walking as Jesus called us to walk. So when we talk about this whole idea of releasing and having compassion and forgiving and freeing somebody, and we say, you know what, I was really upset. Joe offended me on Sunday morning. Joe didn't say hello, but I forgive him. There's a lot of easy ones. But this morning, when we talk about this parable and what Jesus is trying to get across, 100 silver coins is no small amount. These are not small offenses that Jesus is trying to get us to understand that we are to forgive, and to forgive as the King forgave, and to have compassion, and to forgive and to free people. We're to do this regularly, daily, how many times? We never stop doing it. We never stop forgiving. It's impossible to forgive. And this is not just talking about the small things. It's the big things. And I'm just going to tell you this morning that there are some big things that have been done against you, sins against you. And these are, remember, this passage and this context is about the children of God. We're dealing with the siblings in the kingdom, the siblings in God's kingdom. This is when Christians hurt Christians, and they hurt Christians in a really bad way, because 100 silver coins is thousands of dollars. Maybe three, four, five, six, whatever, thousands of dollars. This is a big deal. It's not a small offense. And so he comes back, the man comes back, and look at verse 30. It says, but he refused. Couldn't forgive. Instead, he went off, had the man thrown into prison until he could pay back the debt. This is not how God's children treat one another. No matter what the sin is, no matter how many times it's happened, even if it's a big offense. And the question is why? Why don't God's children treat one another this way, even if a Christian hurts a Christian in a really big way? Why don't we do that? Why don't we treat one another like this man? The reason is because we have received the grace of God in an abundant way that is matchless and boundless, and it could never be even recorded. It is as if billions and billions of dollars had been forgiven to us. It is the grace of God. So what do we do? How do we begin to forgive this way? Jesus is telling Peter, Jesus is telling his disciples, Jesus is telling you and me, how do we forgive like that? Well, we remember. Every single day we remember the love of God toward us in Christ to forgive us and set us free. Every single day we remember. Put it on a plaque if you have to put it on a plaque. Write it on your wall at home. Write it somewhere at home. Put it in your wallet. Buy some custom pajamas. Put it on your pajamas. Whatever you need to do. Remember the grace of God every day. God forgave you in Christ. Everything. We owe him everything. That's where we start. Number three, it helps us to remember that unforgiveness hurts the whole family. I'm going to invite, I think Michelle, would you come and play quietly? And as you do, she comes, I'm going to turn your attention to verse 31. And when the other servants saw what had happened, people will notice our unforgiveness. They'll also notice our love. and our forgiveness. But the servant saw what happened. People see when we harbor bitterness. They see it, they watch it, it impacts them, they're part of the family, and it's they see it, we see it. You're maybe one who's seeing somebody else doing it. You see it and it impacts you. The servant saw. They were outraged. And they went and told their master everything that had happened. Verse 32. And then the master called the servant in. "You wicked servant," he said. "I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you?" Verse 34. In anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured. And look at this. Until he should pay back all he owed. I'm going to go back to the very beginning of the message this morning. Unless we become like little children, we will never, it says, enter the kingdom of heaven. Children just, they might have a little problem, but they let it go. They get over it. They get over it. They get over it. They keep getting over it. This guy is bound until he can pay it back. He's not going to pay back all he owes from prison. The point is there's no way to pay it back. He should have just lived in the grace of the forgiveness and forgotten it. He can't pay it back. Verse 35. As we close this morning, I want you to look at this is the words of Jesus. Look at what he says. "This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart." Forgiveness. It's the hallmark of a true child of the King. We're never more like God except when we forgive.